Gangster with a bad bitch that came from Sri Lanka. Yeah, I'm in a tanga, color of Willy Wonka. You could be the king, but watch the queen come. Okay, first things first, I'll eat your brain. Then I'ma start rocking gold teeth and fangs, cause that's what a motherfucking monster do. The addresser from Milan, that's the monster do. Monster Giuseppe Hill, that's the monster show. Young Money is the roster and a monster crow. And I'm pull up in the bank with the funny face. And if I'm fake, I ain't know this cause my money ain't. Pink with thick ass, give them whiplash. I think big, get cash, make them blink fast. Now look at what you just saw, this is what you live for.
Friends with the
everybody knows I'm a motherfucking monster. I'm a motherfucking monster. Monster. Everybody knows I'm a motherfucking monster.
Yes, please hit the like. Thank you. What's good, y'all? Happy Friday, happy Friday. Please don't pay attention to anything in the background, okay? I got my co-hosts. Both are in the house. They are in the building. Chunk is right here. Coco's right here. We don't know what the hell is going to go down with the background and all like that. I can't control it. I'm okay with not being able to control that. So I'm going to go ahead and bring today's show for you just really quickly. We're going to talk about this movie that's coming out next week. Is it next week? Is June next week? Okay, this movie drops in June. All right, so we're gonna go ahead and get this started. Bro, can you hold it down for me too, just in case I gotta step away? I gotta I think I need to turn that music down in the back because I might get popped for the kid music, believe it or not. Believe it or not. Okay. All right, hold on, y'all. We're gonna get this started. All right, y'all, let's go ahead and get this thing started.
This is Ed Warren. All right, let's get started.
Residents of Brookfield were shocked this afternoon by the broad daylight murder of Bruno Saul.
The court accepts the existence of God every time a witness swears to tell the truth. Well, it's about time they accept the existence of the devil.
Whatever is going on.
Peace, y'all. Hey, welcome to Friday. It's your girl, the Philly Bruja. Hey, y'all. Hey. Welcome to my newly formed gated community. When you are tired of playing on these YouTube streets and seeing all the beefing and the drama. Just really quickly, you guys. Yes, I don't think I had a chance to touch on this. I have created a new gated community for the YouTube streets. When you do not want to indulge in the bullshit and the fuckery, please feel free to come on over here. I'm usually live on Friday afternoon, sometimes randomly at 3 in the morning. It just depends. You got to hit the bell, subscribe. Yes, leave all that other stuff outside. I want you to grab, you know, some flavored water, a margarita, something, you know, leave all that other shit outside. Come on in and sit by the pool. All right, here we are. This is the new YouTube gated community, formerly known as Switzerland. Some of us is neutral out this motherfucker with these beats. However, when you do want to step out and get a little messy and see what's going on, please feel free to do that, okay? But for right now, in this time and in this moment, especially right here at 4:12 on a Friday, it is beautiful here. I hope it's beautiful there, too. We are... All right, y'all, let's get started. Again, forgive the background. Young boy right here and the dog, okay? So let me go ahead and put this on mute and we can listen to the story. I am here live.
When you want to sit down and put your, you know, sit down, relax, put your feet up, take your hair off, sit it to the side, put it in a ponytail, you know, take your baseball cap off. You come on over here with me. You know, we are here in the gated community. You just push a little password in, and the gates is going to open on up, and we come on in. You know, you can grab a drink. You can grab some melon water, you know, maybe grab a crystal somewhere or whatever. You know, come on and sit by the pool and relax, okay? Because that's the kind of vibes I'm trying to get over here in the gated YouTube community. When I want, you know, my best, then I'm going to go ahead and take my ass on out to the YouTube streets. But today, and we're going to talk about The Devil Made Me Do It. And why I'm talking about it is because next month, The Conjuring. They're coming out with another installment of the Lorraine and Ed and Lorraine Warren's vault of paranormal demonology stuff, right? I said that and I just rolled my eyes. I'm like, whatever. So, but the universe itself, the Conjuring universe itself has been, you know, a moneymaker. The only Conjuring that I actually like was the very first one. The rest to me was trash. That's just how I feel. I consider myself a self-proclaimed horror aficionado. I watch them all, okay? Even the ones that's in different languages. One of my favorites happened to be the Japanese ones. Oh, you talking about some scary movies? Yes. Once you get past the subtitles, you just fall right in. Good shit. I literally, like, horror is my thing, right? So I wanted to discuss this whole thing because it's coming out next month. You know, as always, as you can see by the trailer, it looks good, but we gonna see, right? Because the Nun, oh man, whew, epic film. Anyway, first thing is first. What I wanted to discuss was the psychology of blaming the devil, right? Many people use the devil as a metaphor. Now, as an example, you had a Flip Wilson back in the day who would, you know, put on a dress and become Geraldine, and he would do like some outrageous shit, you know, or do something or say something crazy, and then he'll grin in the camera and say like, "The devil made me do it," and then everybody would laugh hysterically because, you know, everyone knew it was a joke, right? Everybody was in on the joke. Oh, hee hee ha ha! It's hilarious. I mean, not to turn this political and racial, but anytime a black man puts on a dress, people find it hysterical. I don't. I am not laughing. I'm not. That's a sarcastic. Yeah, no. I see what y'all do in Hollywood. But anyway, we all knew that Flip was exploiting, you know, theology and, you know, basically to avoid taking responsibility for whatever he was doing at the time, you know, and just turn around all funny and say, "The devil made me do it," you know, and even from then, like, people would be like, "The devil made me do it." And you get off the hook with your parents, your boss, your teacher, your partner. It's kind of like a get out of jail card, you know, like a get out of jail free card kind of thing. If I had to weigh it against something like what we see daily, when people do big bad things, they say, "Well, I'm just a troll. I'm just a troll." So, you know, and everyone's supposed to say, "Oh, you know, it's just a troll. So all the bad behavior is just excused." Does that make sense? I hope that makes sense. It's like a get out of jail card, you know, free. What is it? A get out of jail free card. Yeah. But, you know, Geraldine Flip Wilson, we use it every week. And, you know, the story was hilarious. It was a hit. It was a hit show. You know, it's all fun and it's all hilarious until it's not. Okay. The devil in those taunt terms seems like a magic cloak. It allows you to ignore all accountability. Shit, if I could do something bad and every time and just say, "Hey, the devil made me do it," or "I'm a troll," you know. You know, I mean, who wouldn't take a deal like that? If you could just go ahead and place all the responsibility on, you know, this fictional character that Hollywood has created, you know, horned, pitchforked, you know, that one. But at what cost, you guys? You know what I'm saying? In terms of honor and mental health, I think a lot of times people try to play this shit off as, you know, jokes or kiki or haha, when really it's letting people get away without taking the accountability and also mental health. Okay, that's a big part of this, and I see a lot of that in the spiritual community as well, and on these YouTube streets. Okay, mental health is serious, you guys. There's nothing wrong with getting help. Okay, I think as reasonable adults, somewhat sane adults, okay? I think a lot of times it's better to just say, "You know what? I did it. I'm not proud of it, but I did it. It was me."
the motivation probably comes from a deep, perhaps barely. Oh, you know what? We talked about this, about exploring your shadow self. You know what I'm saying? So let's not put it off on, hey, you know, the devil made me do it, or that's a demon, or, you know what I'm saying? I'm just a troll. Nobody pays me any mind. Or just saying, you know what? This is, I did it. Me. In my lower self, my shadow self. Yep, I did it. You know, not some imaginary being that lets people squirm away from accountability and, you know, and self-exploration, okay? Like the devil and the troll things, that's just not how this works. Is there such thing as a troll? For real? I never seen it. Not a real one. Anyway. A lot of these cases using the devil as a co-defendant, you know what I mean, really should be using accountability. And this is how we're going to get on to the topic today, which is the trial of Ernie Johnson. This was the inspiration for the movie that's dropping next month. It also was the inspiration for the movie, I think, that was made back in the early 80s, and also a documentary, okay? The trial of Ernie Johnson, also known as the Devil Made Me Do It case, is the first known court case in the United States in which defense sought to prove innocence based upon the defendant's claim of a demonic possession and denial, 100% denial of personal responsibility for said crime. Okay, he literally used the devil, air quotes, as a co-defendant in the mastermind of the whole entire fucking event. Okay, so on November 24th in 1981 in Brookfield, Connecticut, there's always some shit going on in Connecticut, you know, as connected to Ed and Lorraine, who I actually think were full of it. All right, I do. They've been exposed so many times, it's ridiculous, but at the same time, hey, get your bag. I'm not hating. God bless both of them. I know Ed has passed along. I think Lorraine has passed on too. But I mean, they've been exposed, these stories, while great and fascinating, and they make great Hollywood productions, a lot of them were bullshit. Okay. On November 24th, 1981, of course, I took notes, in Brookfield, Connecticut, Ernie Johnson was convicted of first degree manslaughter for killing his landlord, Alan Bono. Okay. Now, where did this start? According to the testimony by the Gletzel family, this started with 11-year-old David Gletzel. He was originally the one who had played host to the demon, according to Ed and Lorraine. After witnessing a number of increasing ominous occurrences involving David, the family was exhausted and terrified. They decided to enlist the aid of self-described demonologist, you know, listen to me, self-described demonologist Ed and Lorraine Warren, in a last-ditch effort to cure David. The Gletzel family, along with the Warrens, then proceeded to have multiple priests petition the church, the Catholic Church, to have a formal exorcism performed on David, the child. The process continued for several days, concluding when, according to those present, a demon fled the child's body and took up residence within Arnie. And steps Arnie. Okay, here we are. First and foremost, quote-unquote civilians of this whole thing has no business in a situation like this whatsoever. All right, that's just negligent all the way around. Okay, that's number one. So you got Arnie here, who is the girlfriend of David. Sorry, Arnie is the boyfriend of David's sister. All right, so in this heated exorcism, Arnie was like, you know what? Come into me. Come out of the child and come into me. Take me over, you know. So he was all big and bad. You know, he was like, he's red. What's good? So I guess, you know, this alleged demon said, all right, what's good? You know what I mean? So he jumped in, supposedly, right? Several months later, all right, Arnie killed his landlord during a heated conversation. And we're going to get into that too. His defense lawyer argued in court that he was possessed, but the judge ruled that such a defense could never be proven and was therefore infeasible in the court of law, as it should have been. Period. Let me tell you why. Arnie was subsequently convicted, though he only served 5 years out of the 10 to 20 year sentence. Let me tell you something. The person who murdered my mother, he'll never see the light of day. Okay. I don't care how good he is.
in there. He'll never see the outside again. Every time his ass go up for parole, I'm gonna be right there, God willing. If I'm not, I got 14 siblings and they could just take my spot. Anyway, the trial attracted media attention from around the world. It obtained a high level of notoriety due to the numerous depiction of the events in literature and televisions. We can thank the Warrens for that. The trial was later made into a film. Oh, yeah, it was made into a film called, I think I wrote it down. But the actual TV show, Where Demons Dwell, that was on a haunting episode. I got to catch it because I didn't watch it. They didn't believe in demonic possession itself, you know, or activities, but they claimed their father to be a witness to all of this activity as well. So we got both Arnie, who was the defendant, and Debbie, who was the girlfriend. They were adamant in their support of the Warrens' recollection of events. They asserted that the paranormal activity began after they went to clean up a rental property they had just acquired. David, this is the child, recalled that an old man appeared pushing and terrifying him. The couple initially thought David was using the old man as an excuse to avoid cleaning, but David informed them that the old man had vowed to harm the family if they moved into the rental home. David's visions of the old man included the man appearing as a demonic beast who muttered in Latin. Why do these Catholic demonic entities like that Latin, man? Ooh, I tell you. Anyway, he would mutter in Latin and threaten to steal his soul. Although the family allegedly heard strange noises coming from the attic, no one but David, that's the child, ever witnessed the old man. After David experienced night terrors, exhibiting strange behaviors, and obtained unexplained scratches and bruises, the family called upon the services of the Catholic priest who attempted to bless the house. Just really quickly, you guys, y'all need to be blessing these houses and places before you even spend one night in there, okay? Even if you got your house built brand new from the ground up, you need to do research on the land, okay? Because even if it's not paranormal or supernatural, you need to know what kind of land it is. Because if I can recall correctly, there is a whole section in Philly where they had to bulldoze the houses because the ground itself was sinking. It wasn't nothing supernatural about it. It just, the ground underneath of it was not made to hold that kind of dwelling. So I think now it just looks like a park, which, you know, probably should have just been a park anyway. But at one time, it was row houses. So anyway, the terrified family concluded that the house was evil.
I just wanted to pause it real quick to say welcome, welcome, welcome. Happy Friday to everyone coming in the building now. Peace. I see y'all. I am in these comments. I am multitasking as well. Again, just a quick reminder, you are now entering the land of the gated community of the YouTube streets, okay? All the drama, the beef, all of that, we're going to sit there and put that on the...
I don't like you. I don't like your energy. Stay away, demon.
And would no longer continue to rent. David, that's the child, his visions worsened. It started occurring in the daytime as well. 12 days after the original incident, the family summoned the self-proclaimed demonologists Ed and Lorraine Warren to assist. Again, this couple has been debunked a kabillion times, okay? I'm sorry for the fans. I mean, it makes great Hollywood movies, but no. Anyway, they did catch a bag. Lorraine, allegedly witnessed a black mist materialize next to David, And to her, that was an apparent indication of a malevolent. What is wrong with me? I'm tongue-tied today. Of an evil presence. Debbie and her mother told the Warrens they had seen David being beaten and choked by invisible hands that left red marks and had appeared on his neck afterwards. David had started to growl, hiss, and speak in otherworldly voices. He would recite passages from the Bible as well. They didn't say whether or not he did it in Latin, because then I would be concerned. Anyway, the Blessels recounted how each night a family member would remain awake with David as he suffered through these spasms and convulsions. After receiving a prognosis of multiple possessions from the Warrens, not a doctor, but from the Warrens, David was subjected to 3 lesser exorcisms. I want to put this in here. There is no lesser, more, minor, or major. Once you dip your little pinky toe into the waters. That's it. Okay? Just know that. There is no good, no bad, no, there's no. All right? It is what it is. So Lorraine asserted that David levitated. This couple, again, loves to say that people levitated. Ceased on breathing for long periods of time and even demonstrated supernatural ability, which later on they used that for Ernie's case, okay?
Hit the like. Thank you.
In October of 1980, the Warrens contacted Brookfield police to warn them that the situation was becoming dangerous. According to eyewitness testimony, Ernie Johnson coerced, we just talked about this, one of the demons that was inside of David to possess him while participating in David's exorcism. Ernie ain't handle business, participating in no exorcisms, okay? It is here, and this is coming from a haunting. They veer away from the circumstances of Johnson possession as described by those involved. According to the show, a few days after Johnson ate the demon on during the exorcism, he was attacked rather viciously by a demon, which allegedly took control of his car and forced it into a tree. Fortunately, Ernie Johnson was unharmed. Now, this also goes back to what we're talking about in my last live, jumpers. I think that I did do a video on jumpers, and I don't think that's something I would put on private. So I have to go back and look, and I'll reshare it. If not, I'll just make another one on what a jumper is and what happens. All right, so after this incident, Johnson returned to the rental property. Johnson and Arnie is the same person, by the way, y'all. Rental property to examine an old well that supposedly housed the demon. And both the dramatized version and his personal account, Ernie recollects that this was his final encounter with the demon while completely lucid. After encountering the demon at the well and making contact with it, he became...
Marwan, what you're going to do is behave. And hit the like. Thank you. Hey, A.
Possessed. The Warrens claimed. Wait a minute. Second. See this thing? I got to keep making sure my volume is staying steady. The Warrens claimed to have warned him not to do it, although their warning was not mentioned in the documentary In a Haunting. As David conditioned, the child's condition worsened further. Debbie and Johnson, who had been living in the mother's home, decided it was time to move. Debbie was hired by Alan Bono, that is the victim in this case, a new resident in Brookfield, as a dog groomer. Debbie and Johnson began renting an apartment close to her place of employment. After moving in, Ernie Johnson started to exhibit odd behavior that was strikingly similar to David.
Just real quick, y'all, I just wanted to interrupt myself just to say, y'all got to bear with me with the sound and the audio at that particular point, and even right now, my central ear, it's like 90 degrees here, kicked in, okay? So my bad. Y'all gonna have to bear with me, turn them earplugs up, because I'm not gonna redo it. All right? Please hit the like. Thank you.
Causing Debbie to fear that he had become possessed as well. According to Debbie, Arnie would fall into a trance-like state where he would growl and hallucinate, but later had no memory of it. Okay? So, now we're here in February 16th, 1981. Johnson called in sick to his job at Wright Tree Services and joined Debbie at the kennel where she worked, along with her sister Wanda and Debbie's 9-year-old cousin Mary. Now, keep that in your mind. 9-year-old cousin Mary. Bono, the couple's landlord and Debbie's employer at the kennel, brought the group lunch at a local bar and proceeded to drink heavily. So they all, well, Arnie and Bono, they was getting really saucy and shit, right? So after lunch, the group returned to the kennel. Debbie then took the girls to get pizza, but insisted they return quickly, anticipating trouble. That's because he was drunk, okay? When they returned, Bono intoxicated to the point where he was becoming agitated and was pretty much messing with everyone. So at that time, everyone left the room at Debbie's urging except for Bono. He then began to hold on to Mary, the 9-year-old, and refused to let her go. Now, Arnie had headed back to the apartment in order Bono to release Mary. He ain't handle business with that 9-year-old child, okay? Wanda recounted that she recounted the following events to the police. Mary ran for the car as Debbie attempted to mitigate the situation by standing between the two men. Wanda tried in vain to pull Johnson away. Johnson, this is Arnie, y'all, growling like an animal. Then he drew a 5-inch pocket knife and stabbed Bono repeatedly. Bono died several hours later, according to Arnie's lawyer. Bono had suffered 4 to 5 tremendous wounds, mostly in his chest, and one that stretched from his stomach to the base of his heart. So it's like he literally was gutting him like a fish with that little pocket knife. Crazy. Anyway, Arnie was discovered 2 miles from the site of the murder and was held at Bridgeport Correctional Center on bail of $125,000. Also, this was the first murder in the history of Brookfield, Connecticut. So y'all know the media was going crazy, right? It was everywhere. Everywhere. So the day after the murder, Miss Lorraine Warren, okay, she decided to call the police and was like, yeah, you know, Arnie, he was around when we did this exorcism on this child, David, you know, and at the time, that's when he had became possessed by whatever had David, right? When the crime was committed or whatever. So, you know, with the Warrens being involved, everything surrounding the story just blew up, okay? And, you know, also the Warrens, they got a bag, okay? They did lectures, books. It was a movie.
Quick commercial break. Just welcome to the gated community. I'm gonna let it continue. This is actually about maybe 5 minutes left or so, and then I'll discuss something else real quick with y'all. Oh, the link is in the chat if you want to jump up on here. I got some time. Today is Friday.
Arnie's lawyer was getting calls from all over the world about, you know, what was being called the demon murder trial. He even had the lawyer, Manella, travel to England to meet with other lawyers who have been involved in two similar cases. Neither of those cases in England went to trial. I didn't know. I'm actually looking to see what happened with that. So he had planned to fly in the exorcism specialist from Europe and threatened to subpoena the priest who oversaw the child's original exorcism if they did not cooperate with the defense. That's crazy. Johnson served almost 5 years of the 10 to 20 sentence for his November 1981 conviction on a reduced charge of first-degree manslaughter. He was scheduled for parole on February 26, but was released early because of his good behavior. I honestly feel like had the alcohol and stuff not have been involved, and they could have proved that Bono was actually trying to harm this child, he might have got away with even less time, if any. You know, but anyway, in pretrial hearings, Johnson claimed that he had became possessed by demons after challenging the devil, air quotes, to leave a 12-year-old boy and enter him during an exorcism. He said he killed Bono while under the devil's spell. And this whole thing with the devil, and it's just giving way too much accolades to the fictional, you know, thing that we think the devil is. You know what I'm saying? It's a hierarchy here. You know what I'm saying? Like, the real devil is booked. I mean, the energy of the devil is booked and busy. Don't you see what's going on out here? A Superior Court judge refused to allow Johnson's defense of innocence by demonic possession. Rightfully, okay? Nevertheless, the case attracted widespread attention. A book was written, because you know the Warrens, they gonna get that bag, okay? And they did make a movie. The movie was called The Demon Murder Case, and it starred Andy Griffin and Kevin Bacon. I never saw it. I'm gonna have to go back into the archives and see it. But while in prison, Johnson got married. Johnson is Arnie, y'all. He received his high school diploma. While he was in there, he earned several other educational certificates, and he took a number of college courses. That's according to the chief of parole at the time for the State of Corrections Department. He was basically a model inmate, right? And his mental condition was carefully examined, and they found nothing negative, no negative factors at all, because he probably got on meds, okay? And in this particular, I'm talking about the child. The child probably got some help. And in this particular case, to me, it seemed like everybody was just, they don't call them spirits for nothing. Everybody was drinking and getting saucy, and you know, it's a bad day, all right? But his condition was found to be, for the most part, normal. There's no negative factors that would have stopped him from getting parole. Anyway, the board voted unanimously after the hearing in December to allow Johnson to be released early. All right, so this is just a quote, right? Possessions doesn't last 24 hours a day, Ed Warren said. It comes quickly and leaves quickly. Arnie understands what happened to him. He now knows if something happens, how to ward it off, and he won't be stupid enough to take on the devil again. This, my friends, is a complete lie, and it's bullshit. And let me tell you something. Possession does not come quickly and leave quickly. That is a lie. it starts off slow, even before the actual target is possessed or, you know, starts getting infected with that kind of energy. You're going to see signs. You're going to see stuff like the other story. You had big ass flies in the wintertime, right? You're going to see the increase in roaches and mice, like that kind of shit. You're going to see all that. Smells, bad smells. That's even before that kind of energy picks its actual target. And, you know, unfortunately, the weaker ones is the ones who usually who catch it, right? Anyway, Carl, now in steps Carl. So that is David's brother, who at the time of this, well, after all of this, in this particular interview, he was 42 years old, right? Living in Brookfield. He says, right, that the demon claim from the Warrens was all a hoax. It was designed to bring the Warrens more money, more fame. And he says his brother David suffered from mental illness as a young boy that led to hallucinations and delusions, but has since recovered and now owns his own construction business. They saw a gold mine. This is what David's brother said. He said, we are not going to be ridiculed again. He was like, I'm not going through this shit anymore. This is not happening again. He said that the boys, they were shunned by their friends, classmates. They even had trouble getting work later because of the notoriety of the case. He said, David himself, he don't want to comment. He don't even want to talk about it. The crazy thing is this movie is coming out next month, and you got people like me and others who's all up in the business once again, right? I'm not going to be contacted with these people whatsoever. I'm not looking at nothing like that. I'm just going by what's here, right? So, yeah, it's unfortunate. The shit's coming out again next month, and people are going to be looking into it. I am one of those, okay? But the brother said, I ain't going through this shit again, and neither is my brother. He actually sued the Warrens. They sued him, right? And at the time, Lorraine was, I think, 80 years old or something like that. She said it was ridiculous, saying, you know, this comes 25 years after the first book was published. She said the six Catholic priests attended the exorcism, and she and her husband witnessed some behavior. So that's it. That's it. That's all. And that's just the truth. And don't question nothing, because we got the backing of the Catholic priest and the Catholic church. And, you know, she was like saying, I said what I said. But they did settle for an undisclosed amount. Hopefully, David and his family were able to move past it now. You know what I'm saying? Hopefully. And Arnie and his family, you know, that tragic event, and also, you know, the victim's family, hopefully everyone has come to some kind of peace with it all. I don't know how, especially with another Hollywood hit coming out next month, and people going to be all up in the business once again. That's, you know, here we are. And Warrens, if I'm not mistaken, I think Lorraine has already passed on along with her husband, Ed. I do think that they were full of it, but, you know, it made for great TV. Now, this is the point where I'm going to talk about what is this whole devil energy and can you sell your soul? How much is it? You know, like that kind of thing. Hopefully. We're going to go ahead and we'll get into that. Okay. I just wanted to pre-record this part, you know, while I was fighting.
No good blood sucker, fat motherfucker. Now look who's in trouble. As you itch, I'm a monster. No good blood sucker, fat motherfucker. Now look who's in trouble. As you itch, I'm a monster. No good blood sucker, fat motherfucker. Now look who's in trouble. As you run through my jungles, all you hear is rumbles. Kanye West samples. Here's one for example.
In a monster automobile gangster with a bad bitch that came from Sri Lanka. Yeah, I'm in a tanka, color of Willy Wonka. You could be the king, but watch the queen conquer. Okay, first things first, I'll eat your brain. Then I'ma start rocking gold teeth and fangs, cause that's what a motherfucking monster do. He a dresser from Milan. That's
all right, y'all. So that was the video on the story of The Conjuring. Okay, the next one that's coming out is released, I think it's June 20th, I think, something like that. But that is the real story behind that whole particular feature that's coming out. As per usual, the Warrens is doing the most, as they did in life. None of that other stuff was really proven. And no, this guy did not get off by using the devil, okay?
I think that some people really need to hold themselves accountable for the shit that they do. You just can't run around here saying the devil made me do it, or I'm a troll, you know, that's just what I do. No, sometimes we need to hold ourselves accountable for the shit that we do. That's just a little advice for when you leave the gated community. Okay. Now, I will say, though, I did come across one case a couple years ago. This motherfucker, excuse me, this one right here, Nico, this one. Yeah, I definitely think demons, possessions, all that shit was involved in his particular case, and also with his whole entire family. I'm talking about a family of possessed motherfuckers. Okay, yes, this one, Nico, I do think definitely it was possession. Hold on a second, let me I'm gonna cut that background down. Hold on, sorry, y'all.
The monster do, monster Giuseppe Hill as the monster show. Young Money is the roster and a monster crow. And I'm all up in the bank with the funny face. And if I'm fake, I ain't notice cause my money ain't pink with kick ass, give them whiplash. I think big kick cash, make them blink and land. Now pink with kick ass, give them whiplash. I think big kick cash, make them blink and land. Now pink with kick ass, give them whiplash. I think big kick cash, make them blink and land. Now look at what you just saw, this is what you live for.
All right, y'all, I'm back. I'm sorry. I had to, I put that on mute because Chunk went back upstairs with his sisters. But yes, this one, this story, this whole entire case, and if you look into the family's background and history too, that's not just mental illness. That was demonic shit right there. I'll get into that at another time. But I also wanted to touch on this as well. The whole concept of selling your soul. One second, y'all. Please hit the like. Thank you. Okay. Yeah, look him up. That's going to take you down a whole different rabbit hole. Okay? A whole complete, just put a weekend in on it. Him, his family, all of them. I'm not really one who really believes in generational curses and things of that nature, but it's definitely something supernatural, paranormal going on in that man's background, not just with him, but with his entire family. This motherfucker right here. Okay. Yes, him. Now, yes, please hit the like. Thank you. And donate. I don't even know what my Cash App is. Anyway, please hit the like. Thank you. Man, I wanted to get on this whole topic real quick, and I'm going to touch it briefly. I don't see anybody back here. I got a lot of shit going on with these screens, but it's nice. Yes, honey. Nice and quiet behind the gates. Please. Yes, this is our special gated community. Yes, our very special gated community. And y'all know I don't hold y'all long, so y'all can get back to the mess momentarily. Now, selling your soul. As I spoke many times before, I don't personally believe in a devil, you know, like the one that Hollywood, this one, this charismatic looking creature right here. I don't believe in the devil, not this. I mean, the energy itself, yes. I even talked about jumpers before. We'll get into that another day. But this one, this little handsome devil, so to speak, right there, I don't believe in that. So I feel like, yes, barbed wires, gates, all of that in a security code. Okay. Yeah. I don't believe in this particular thing, right? This. However, there is a way you can go ahead and give your soul, you know, over to that particular kind of energy, right? Now, with that, again, like anything, there is no coming back from that. I'm not even going to get into how or anything like that, because I told you I don't give out rituals and things of that nature. But there's all kind of energy out here. You even got like that kind of energy. I mean, it's all like a demonic kind of energy, you know, anytime something has that kind of control over you. But I want you to think about this. Not everybody has a soul worth bargaining. Okay, not everyone does. I don't know why people get that impression, like, well, you know, I'm gonna go ahead and sell my souls. It's not everybody has them. Not everybody has a soul that's actually worth something. Some of you motherfuckers, it's nothing in there. There's nothing in there. So you can't bargain if you don't have anything in there, or if it's already, you know, taken. That kind of thing. There's nothing to bargain with. There's nothing to bring to the table here. You know what I mean? Some people are just deplorable. You know, some folks was just born to be chaos dwellers. So again, when you think about that whole, when people want to say, oh, well, this rapper or this entertainer, what? Well, you gonna find out when you wake up dead, right? I was getting ready to say, some people's souls ain't worth shit. Okay. Some people were born as vessels to carry on the chaos, because in order for this dimension to have balance, they go my co-host, in order for this dimension to have balance, you're going to need chaos creators, right? You're going to have the folks who are able to combat that chaos creator and that energy, and as long as you have empaths, you're going to have narcissistic people, and you know, people who display demonic behavior, period. He's looking all handsome in this picture to me. If I don't say so myself, my co-host is jumping up and going crazy. Nobody's back here, so that's cool. I'm gonna go ahead and call it a day. You know, I'll see y'all around these YouTube streets at some point. I'm gonna go ahead and, you know, make some food for the childrens and whatnot, or maybe just order out. It is the weekend, right? I should be off as a mama on the weekends. At least that's what I think. My husband can take you over from here. But yeah, some people don't have souls to bargain with, okay? So you can do all the rituals that you want. You can bring all the shit to the table, and then when it's time to get to the negotiation part of it, and it'll be like, wait, you ain't got no damn soul. Your soul ain't shit. Some people, like I said, are just here to be vessels. The actual devils, they look like you, me, and anybody else. Okay? The actual devils look like you, me, and anybody else. And I would suggest that you teach your children that as well. Okay? Yes. Yes, Coco is possessed. Coco's possessed by anybody who walks up even their own driveway. Okay? They could be houses down up their own driveway. Coco is going to bark. She's going to mess up every live that I do. Y'all just going to have to deal with it. But yes, not everyone has a soul worth selling. That's not how this works at all. Peace, Michael Phillips. You're going to have to hit the replay, because I'm about to go ahead and shut it down. Again, thank you all for joining me in our private little gated community. I'm gonna try to get up on here as much as I can as far as doing lives. When I find different topics, you can always post them under the comments or DM me on Instagram. You know, if you got something you want me to. But yes, you know, I enjoyed our little hour or so here, you know, in the gated community of the YouTube streets. All right, y'all have a beautiful, beautiful, beautiful weekend. I know I'm not coming live this weekend anytime soon, but you know, as always, thank you for joining me. Catch the replay. Please hit the like. Thank you. And as always,
fuck this shit, I'm out. Fuck this shit, I'm out.
No thanks.
Don't mind me. I'ma just grab my stuff and leave. Excuse me, please. Fuck this shit, I'm out.
Nope.
Fuck this shit, I'm out.
Alright then.
I don't know what the fuck just happened, but I don't really care. I'ma get the fuck up out of here.
Fuck this shit, I'm out.